In this lecture, we'll cover the theories of deviance as given by the Chicago School. The structural functional perspective said that deviance can also be positive and it is not necessarily always negative. Therefore, it can bring social change. When you raise your voice against something, at that moment of time, some people might consider you as a deviant, that you are not adhering to the rules of the society. But if you look at the bigger picture, you might be bringing in a social change. For example, there were many activists, feminists, who turned out to be later called as feminists, who stood up for the violence against women, who stood up for the oppression against women. So at that point of time, they were deviants. But if we look at what they did now, if we look at the big picture, we see that that deviant behavior that they showed then has changed the society, the view of society. They have changed how they look at women now. So that is how deviance can also lead to conformists. Now, when we talk about the Chicago School, it is also known as the ecological school, and they say that the social environment where we are brought up, where we are living, it is a very important factor which decides whether one will become a deviant or not. So it is a critical school, and it talks about urban sociology, criminology, and it uses the symbolic interactionist approach. It is also helpful in addressing the contemporary social problems, because the theories, the classical theories that were made then, may not be applicable in the society today. As the society keeps on changing, new contemporary problems arise, and therefore we need new and different theories. So we'll discuss the thinkers from Chicago School one by one, beginning with Edwin Sutherland. He talked about differential association. Please remember this term. What he said in this theory was, individual associates himself with a group which has different values from where he was brought up. For example, I was told that in my family or in my society, I was told that honesty is the best policy. But I go around in my society, or perhaps away from my society, and meet with a group of people, and I get influenced with them, and I associate with their values, and their values can be honesty is not the best policy. So what will I do? I will get influenced from them, and I will choose that value, that virtue, and imbibe it in my life. So when I imbibe the virtue of honesty not being the best policy, I will surely become deviant. I will cheat. I will break the laws, right? Coming to the next thinker, that is David Miller. In his theory, he said that sometimes the lower class people, they feel inferior, and they feel that they're not the part of the mainstream society. So what do? In order to not feel inferior, they withdraw the group that they are in, they withdraw the membership, and they join some different group. And that different group, they give them different values. Again, the same thing. For example, a poor man's child, he feels that he should get new toys, he should go to a good school, but his father cannot afford it. So when he sees other people's children going to better schools, playing with good toys, he might feel inferior, and he would like to become a part of that group. Now that group, because they are from a rich background, a wealthy background, they have different values than the child who is brought up in a poor household. So in that case, he would want his lifestyle to be like them, and he would, or he could, indulge in a deviant behavior to attain that kind of lifestyle. Next theory is by Cloward and Olin. They talked about illegitimate opportunities, where what happens is individuals, they cannot keep up, or they cannot keep track of what the changes are happening in the society around them. Because if you've noticed, every day you wake up, you would read the news, and something new has been invented. Technology has taken a new path, something new is invented every now and then. So it is also inspired from Merton's strain theory, which says that when the goals and ends are not in configuration, it creates some strain. So in this theory, it was mainly based on the juveniles, and they said that what happens is when they cannot keep up with the changes in the society, they associate with three different kinds of culture. That is criminal subculture, where they can become a part of a gang. Second is conflictist subculture, where they can turn into revolutionaries and revolt to the things happening in the society. Or they can be a part of retreatist subculture, where they give up everything and live an ascetic life like a saint or a hippie. The next theory is by David Madza. He wrote the book Delinquency and Drift. In this book, he has talked about mainly the middle class people and how they derive pleasure from being deviant. So he says that there is a deviant culture, the culture of deviance. For example, Eve teasing. They seek pleasure in it. They find it that they attain some kind of pleasure. He has also talked about the role of family, where family can play a direct or indirect role in a person's behavior. For example, if you've been neglected by your parent for a really long time, you will try to gain attention from others. And when you go out and try to seek attention or try to seek love, you could end up in a wrong company, and as a result, you can become deviant. So he talks about three reasons why this happens. First is affinity, where you become friends with higher class people. Next is affiliation, when you become friends with gangsters. And the last is significance, to get recognition. The same way, if your parents do not appreciate you, they do not recognize and appreciate whatever you are doing for them, you might go out and seek approval from others. And this is the kind of reason where you could become deviant. The next theory is given by William Isaac Thomas. In his book, The Polish Peasant, he has talked about three types of personality. First is Philistine, who are conformists. They stick to the rules, they do not experiment, and they accept with the social traditions and the social norms. Second is Bohemian, who find it pleasurable, or they like to break the rules. And the last is Creative. This is the best kind of personality. What they do is they act according to the situation. So if they have to be deviant, they will be. And if they find that the rules of society are in their favor, so they'll adhere to it. The next theory is by Robert Jr., who says that overconformity is also deviance. We know that too much of anything or excessive of anything is also detrimental to us. So what happens is when this kind of person, he accepts everything that is being told to him. So if a person is overeating and has gained weight, and if the society tells him you are really fat and you should not be like this, this is not acceptable, so what he will do, he will stop eating at all, or he will become anorexic. That is, he will eat and then he will vomit the food out and become anorexic. So he will stop eating entirely. So this could be the case. So this is the case of overconformity. The next thinker is Stuart Palmer, who has written the book Psychology of Murderers. In this book, he has read and studied the case history of criminals, and he found out that when there is a deprivation, when the child feels deprivated because his parents probably neglected him or gave preference to his siblings, in this case, he is likely to become a deviant as he grows up. Now, there is a situation called survival of the fittest, but in this theory by W.G. Sumner, we are going to talk about survival of the unfittest. So this is a paradox where the everyday norms are violated. The best cannot survive in the society because of the norms or situations in the society. For example, if there is a dancer and the society tells her not to carry on with her occupation, but because she is passionate about it, she would still do it, and she might cut off from that society and become deviant for those particular members, but perhaps not for others. So that is survival of the unfittest. The next theory is labeling theory by Howard Becker. The society tells you what is good and what is not good, and they give you labels. They tell you what labels should be given to who and why, and what happens as a result. For example, if you think that a person is an alcoholic, the society has given him the tag of alcoholic. Why? Because he is always drinking alcohol, perhaps. And as a result, what happens? The society may tell him to leave that society, or it may tell other members to not be in contact with him. This could lead in a low self-image or the low self-esteem of that person, and in turn he could become deviant. The next theory is the control theory given by Walter Reckless. He has talked about two components, that is internal control and external control. Internal control is what you've been told from your childhood, like you should be a good person, you should not break the law. So whenever you are about to do something bad, your conscience, it stops you. It tells you, don't do this, be a good person. Or it tells you about the consequences, that you could land up in jail. So it stops you. And the external control are the institutions like police and law and judiciary, which tells you that if you do something wrong, you are going to get punishment for the same. So these kind of restraints, they form a person's self-control. So if I keep telling myself I have to be a good person, I do not have to break the law, I have to keep my parents' reputation and everything, so I will become a good person and I will gain self-control. So this was told by Travis Hershey, who talked about that these restraints form our self-control. So when children who lack this self-control at the beginning years only, they may grow up to become deviants because they do not have that kind of self-control. Now let us look at some questions. There's an assertion. In order to be eligible for a sport, an athlete must be in his best shape. The reason: the athlete stopped eating and started on unnatural supplements to achieve his goal weight. So the answer will be D. A is right, and reason is correct also, because we are talking, in the question they have asked about overconformity. So overconformity is when the person would do anything to gain the goal. So that is overconformity. Second question, failure to meet expected norms leads to deviance. When Mahatma Gandhi refused to adhere to norms of the first class whites only seats in the train and challenged apartheid, what was it? So it was a form of deviance, but it brought social change. So it was deviance for the whites, who told him that you are a black person and you cannot sit here. But because he opposed it, because he showed deviance, it brought a social change and he challenged apartheid. So thank you for watching.